morning. Good morning to the folks sitting in the sanctuary. And you internet people, well, can't hear me, so I could say anything about you that I want, huh? So, no, we love you. We love you. And just welcome. Welcome here to our beautiful center, our Center for Spiritual Living. You know, lately I've been taking to, in my own head, calling it the Kindness Cathedral. I don't know why. I don't know if you like that name, but you guys can get back to me on that if you like. But you know what? I have to tell you, the reason that I'm keeping it private for myself now is that I'm not sure that I can live up to that. You know? When people ask you, where do you work, after you've just like chewed out a bank teller, I work at the Kindness Cathedral, you know? But in the spirit of the Kindness Cathedral, I am carrying a mask with me somewhere, just in case anybody wants me to put a mask on. I am happy to do it. If you are more comfortable when I'm speaking with you directly, if you want me to put a mask on. I see somebody going like, no, but if anybody wants me to put a mask on while I'm speaking with you directly, I'm happy to do it. In the spirit of kindness and taking care of others and the greater good. With that in mind, I wanted to pass it over to our brother Brock, who is a former board president and my helper today.
Hi.
Hi.
Well, all I have to do is say hi. It's comedy. old friends, new friends, it's so wonderful to see you. This idea sort of bubbled up out of Reverend Bonnie in the last week or so about a cathedral of kindness.
Kindness Cathedral.
It's
like the Crystal Cathedral.
You got to get it in that order because it's reminiscent of the Crystal Cathedral.
That's right.
Yeah, it's very, very important. Mm-hmm. And she just floated it and people clapped. Mm-hmm. So this is good.
Yeah.
I'm completely down with that. So maybe just close your eyes for a second and just imagine, remember, you know, there's the saying thank you for your service to medical people, to nurses and folks like that. Remember the children from India? And at one point Bonnie went and did some work in Jordan. And then there's the countless tiny acts of kindness that we are inspired to do on a daily basis, locally and globally. And we are a part of that. It's a great blessing to be a part of that, to be in service in that way. So welcome, welcome. So glad you're here.
Thank you, Brother Brock. Appreciate that. Who's next? Bill Hadris. Bill Hadris is our, well, he's our, what? Ambassador, yeah. It's really funny without the cameras on. We can do anything. Right.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Bill Hadris of the Youth and Family. And this morning, let's do a balance check. I'm gonna do this, and I invite you, just kidding. let's close our eyes, take a deep breath, relax, and think. What are a few of your favorite things to do? Either alone, with friends, or with your family. Now, are there things you think you should do more or less of in your life? When does life feel the least out of balance? And what do you feel you have control over, and what do you think in your life is controlling you? When we make healthy choices based on our soul's desire, we open our lives to the true calling of spirit. As we go to our source for our clarity and guidance, We are divinely guided and balanced in how we live each and every day. So I invite you to repeat after me. Balance is within me.
Balance is within me.
And so it is.
And so it is. Thank you, Bill. Those were great questions. I like those. Thanks. All right, and here comes Christine, who is our practitioner, and she's going to lead us in prayer.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. I invite you once again to take a deep breath. To close your eyes and just bask in the beauty of being here today. And I invite practitioners and ministers who are present and who are in cyberspace to stand. Isn't it wonderful to know that we are here together, knowing that God is all there is. There is this source, there is this energy of love that permeates the universe and is here with us, all around and through us, and we are love. And I'm so grateful to know that I am one with this source, with this love. I know that to be my truth, and I know that to be the truth for everyone present, everyone viewing this in cyberspace. We are all one. And we come together. It's so wonderful to be here in the sanctuary again. So grateful for this opportunity. So grateful. So grateful for Reverend Bonnie, knowing that she is divinely guided with wisdom and courage and laughter and humor and love. So grateful for our musicians and our singers and our technical people and the people behind the scenes who make this service possible. So grateful for this opportunity to be here today. Remembering that it's Father's Day, remembering the fathers or father figures in our lives who are with us or who may have passed on. Also celebrating the wonderful solstice, this energy that comes from that. Just basking in the love and being together, knowing the surface unfolds perfectly. And with a heart that is profoundly grateful, I release these words into the mystery.
Thank you, Christine, for your beautiful words. Let us breathe together and begin to remember. Remember the truth of our existence, that the I Am presence is who we are, that it lives and moves its being within us, that everything that we see is the I Am. I Am, that I Am, is the name of God or love or whatever it is, the energy and the consciousness that fulfills this universe. That is that mystical place of non-duality that embraces everything and that is everything. And we are part of that. We are one with that, and it is one with us, and it is part of us. We are like a drop in the ocean of the I Am, but we are also the ocean in the drop. And so we sing together and remember our true nature, the true presence of the I Am moving through us as we sing. Together we sing, I Am Remembering.
I am remembering.
We rest in the divine remembrance, feeling the fullness and the emptiness of that. How beautiful it is to dwell in this paradox and to know that it guides us through our lives. And so in full awareness, let us breathe in deeply and then exhale, opening our eyes in love and in service to what is, as it is, and so it is. From our virtual choir.
It's so good to be together now with you here in this place. It's so good to be together with a smile on my face. Gonna let the Spirit move me, gonna shower you with love. It's so good to be together in this place. It's so good to love each other and the Spirit to embrace. It's so good to love each other. With God's love we have grace. Gonna let the Spirit move me, gonna shower you with love. It's so good to love each other in this place. It's so good to be together. Everyone here has a place. It's so good to love each other and the whole.
That was awesome. Are we online yet? Okay, cool, cool. Now we can, what? We're oh. Okay, good to know. I forgot about that. Okay, well, let me start by saying praise the Lord. And, so funny. Okay, so let's hear from the fathers. Who's a father? Will you stand up and let us acknowledge you? Thank you, everybody. Jennifer, you're a father? You were standing up. Okay, never mind. Okay, so yeah, happy Father's Day to everybody, and we're just so, so grateful for what you brought forth in the world and just for doing what you do. It's just a remarkable thing that, I don't know, I think, you know, sometimes I feel like I have a hard job, and then I think about parenting, and I'm like, whoa, that's much harder, right? Wouldn't you say? I mean, you don't know what I do, but it's the hardest job in the world, I would say. So anyway, I wanted to start this message by telling you some news that I found out, and I thought you should probably hear it from me first. And that is that somebody, while I wasn't looking, changed the laws of science, particularly the laws of physics and gravity. And I say this because I had a bad encounter with a slide, a kiddie slide, you know? Something that you slide down? Yeah. I went to my little nephew's, my great nephew's home. My sister hasn't been able to travel because of COVID, and she came into LA where my little nephew lives. So I went to see them. And my little nephew is 4. And what do you guys know about 4-year-olds? Full of energy and smart. And they want, you know, Tante Bonnie. Tante is German, aunt in German. Tante Bonnie to do everything, and Tante Bonnie can't say no. So she's, you know, I'm running around on this bouncy house, burning my feet on the soles of it. We had this encounter with whipped cream. There's this game called Pie Face. Anybody ever played that? Yeah, it's awesome. But basically, it's like Russian roulette, and you turn this thing, and there's an arm that's loaded with whipped cream, and you turn it, and then it hits you in your face at some point, but you don't know when it's coming. So I probably ate about half a can of whipped cream, and that didn't feel so great. And what else? Oh, I played hopscotch and did something else dastardly to my body. But the worst was the kiddie slide. And it wasn't a tiny kiddie slide, it was a big kiddie slide. It was about this tall, and you had to climb up a little tiny ladder to get on it, and it had to fit through a little space. I wasn't sure if I would fit. And then as I'm climbing up, my sister said, very kindly, your bottom might be too big, you might have to go down sideways. But I didn't. I was so proud of myself. You know how they say pride cometh before a fall? I was so proud of myself that my bottom did actually fit in the kiddie slide. And I thought it was going to be slow because there was going to be drag on it because of my bottom, you know? But it wasn't. I sped down that slide and got spit out the end. And have you seen on... SeaWorld, when like Shamu leaps into the air and then lands like that? That was me. I was Shamu. I was Shamu, people. But I landed on dirt, not water. So I came home to my husband afterwards. I'm like, I'm all torn up. It's really hard. But it felt to me like the laws of gravity had changed because they didn't apply to me like they used to. And we know that that's not true. That's why we're laughing, is that perhaps my body had changed. Ladies, you remember that movie that we saw when we were like 13, Our Changing Bodies? Remember that? Well, I think they should make one for old people too, Our Changing Bodies. So, yeah, the geriatric version. So, anyway, you know, it reminded me so much of something that Ernest Holmes said about reality. And he said that reality does not change. Rather, we change our position in reality. And clearly, I had changed my position in gravity and physics. And we often change our position in reality, which means that we are thinking that reality should be this way, and then we want it to be something else. So we can change our reality in a way that is constructive, or we can change our reality in a way that we think is going to help but doesn't help. Prayer is one of those things that helps us position ourselves in reality in a very constructive way. Prayer opens us up to the spiritual truth, which is always greater than the facts. Ernest Holmes said that spiritual truth is superior to worldly facts. And so prayer is one way that we move into this place of greater reality. We position ourselves in a beautiful, receptive place in the truth of Spirit's love. The problem with that is that the ego doesn't like it very much. The ego often wants to fight with what our spiritual intuition tells us to do. So what is the ego? First of all, everyone has one. You don't have to be ashamed if you have an ego. You know, sometimes we want to be egoless, but everybody has one. It's just part of the divine mystery, and it's there for a reason. It actually helps us to navigate. One of the things that the ego does is that it sorts and it categorizes. Often it looks like this is good, this is bad, this is evil, this is good, this is joy, this is sorrow, one is bad, one is good. But the ego also helps us discern so we can navigate life. I was thinking, as I was pondering this topic, about what it would be like. You know, everything is God, right? But there's this story by Dr. Seuss, and I know Dr. Seuss is not accepted in some circles, and I think of Dr. Seuss as someone that perhaps made some mistakes in his early career and then went on to write a very redemptive body of work. So anyway, this Dr. Seuss story, maybe you've heard it. Let's see, how does it go? It goes, did I ever tell you of Mrs. McCabe, who had 23 sons and named them all Dave? Now, that wasn't a very smart thing to do, for whenever she wanted one and called out, yoo-hoo, come into the house, Dave, not one, but 23 Daves would come on the run. And then she goes on to say what she should have named them, all kinds of comical names. But, you know, first of all, we can sort of use the ego to sort and categorize that story, like, who was this Mrs. McCabe, and why? How did she get those 23 sons? She a saucy minx who just was, or maybe she's part of a cult, or maybe Maybe it's an orphanage and she's doing good work. You know, we just don't know. There's this reality to Mrs. McCabe that the child, the innocence in us, doesn't comprehend, but the sorter in us, the egoic software, will figure it out and then label it good or bad, right? And that's really where the challenge with the ego comes in. First of all, yes, it's good. Because if we're all God, we still have to discern who is who in this earth plane existence. We can't say, oh, who did the prayer this morning? Oh, God, over there, God did it. Who did the morning welcome with me? That was God. Who's going to sing later? Oh, God and God. Who played the piano? God. Who completely messed up the tech? God, God, God. And God and God. Or it might have been the internet, God, okay? So anyway, who kindly warned me that we were still online or being recorded? God, right? So you see how things have to be named. I think of Adam naming the animals in the Old Testament. You know, things have to be named so we can figure things out. But where we get in trouble is where we start attaching emotion and clinging and rejection to those things. You know, that story that I told about Mrs. McCabe, we had judgments on those various scenarios that I put out there, that she's a saucy minx or that she's in a cult or that she's running an orphanage. Even if she is running an orphanage, I would say that's the good one. It's pretty strange to name all the kids Dave, though, don't you think? Right? But anyway, so that's what the ego does. It sorts and it discerns, but it also clings and rejects, and it has judgment on what's happening, rather than seeing the bigger spiritual picture, which is that God is good. There is no God but God, right? God, only God is good, and that there is this hidden treasure that longs to be known in everything, that loves to be known in everything. So I don't want to say stuck, but we're infused with this egoic energy by virtue of our existence. Like I said, we all have it, but what do we do about it? And that's where prayer comes in, and that's where the ego might start to kick and scream a little bit, because the ego's judgment and the ego's clinging and the ego's pushing away feels like it's helping us. But in truth, we get to, and particularly in a spiritual center like this, where we're always looking at ourselves and raising ourselves up, we get to move past that and do something different, do something that will really, truly connect us with God. When I think about connection with God in terms of prayer, one of the purposes of prayer, this is an old-time religion word, but I'm going to use it and explain what it really means, is repentance. Now, many of us who were raised in a challenging Christian path, or other, I'm not sure, other paths perhaps as well, use that word to make a list of inappropriate, sinful, unkind, bizarre behaviors that we needed to correct in order so that God would love us. God would love us once we corrected those behaviors. Am I right from any, like, people that were raised in that? I wasn't really raised in that type of tradition, but is that close? Okay. So again, that is an egoic projection onto religion. That's not exactly what repentance means. And then also, by the way, you know, I don't think that any religion is free from that, because we're always projecting our ego onto even vast things like religion, you know, spirituality. In this denomination, Science of Mind or Centers for Spiritual Living, we have been known to do the same thing. We would say what I sometimes call a more sophisticated version of self-shaming, you know? We have it down to an art form, because, you know, in this teaching we say that our consciousness creates our conditions, and so if somebody's experiencing a bad condition, we can often judge them and say that your consciousness has created those conditions. Or we can judge ourselves. If we are experiencing a quote-unquote bad condition, we think that we're doing something wrong or that we're unworthy. I know that I go through this as a minister. You know, I have this secret fear, phobia. Don't tell anybody, okay? I have this secret fear that all the other ministers know what they're doing and I don't. They've all read some special book or seen some special movie, and I didn't know that was the assignment. I don't know what I'm doing. But, you know, it's a matter of consciousness, you know. Probably all of you have had prayer fails, right? Anybody? Raise your hand if you've had a prayer fail, something that didn't turn out quite the way like you thought it should. And if you don't want to raise your hand, just raise your pinkies. Stay honest, okay? What you would call a prayer fail. I have so many examples, but they're all confidential, things that I prayed for other people and things that I prayed for myself that were like, turned out completely different than we anticipated. Ultimately better. But when you're in the midst of the prayer fail, we start to shame ourselves. We start to say, I must be doing something wrong. I don't have the consciousness. God doesn't like me. Whatever it is, we start doing something wrong. And the truth about prayer is that it doesn't always turn out like we expect, because there's a greater mind. There's a greater mind that is actually doing the work through us. You know, there's that song that I love. You know, I love the Fantastics, that musical. And there's that song that says, plant a radish, get a radish. Never any doubt. Once you've planted vegetables, you know what you're about. And we think it should be that way. Okay, I think of thoughts of abundance, and I should have abundance immediately. Right? But it doesn't always happen that way. Sometimes when we pray, things kind of fall apart first so that the newness can be reborn. I mean, look at the pandemic, right? Everything fell apart. Everything fell apart. Church fell apart. Church was kooky, and it still is a little kooky. But I'm holding fast to the idea that it fell apart so that it could be lifted up into something newer and greater. And whatever is going on in your life, same thing. If something is falling apart, it is there for that trinity that Richard Rohr talks about, which is order, chaos, and order, disorder, and reorder. Okay? Right now in the church, we're kind of in the disorder phase, which is actually fun if you relax and go with it, right? Okay. So I talked about repentance in the old terms, but really it's a translation of the word in Greek metanoia, which means going beyond the mind. I used to think it was changing the mind, and I used to think, well, I'm just going to change the mind of my ego. I'll just think better thoughts. I'll think harder, and then I'll be able to improve myself. But it's not that. Let me read you what Cynthia Bourgeau says about that, what the word metanoia means. The word metanoia, usually translated as repentance, literally means to go beyond the mind or into the larger mind. It means to escape from the orbit of the egoic operating system, which by virtue of its own internal hardwiring is always going to see the world in terms of polarized opposites and move instead into that new non-dual knowingness. So metanoia is not changing the mind of our ego. It is surrendering the ego and moving into that place of the big mind, the large mind, the great mind, where we release ourselves from the egoic operating system, and we are able to see the world as one. We are able to see the world as wholeness. And that's foreign to a lot of us. It's foreign to a lot of us. But you know what? Every time we get stuck in something, every time we get stuck in a dilemma, every time we get stuck in a crisis, this is a calling to move into that prayer, which is moving into that mind of wholeness. You know, I've used the word shame a lot. Like, what if we're feeling ashamed of ourselves? What if we're shaming somebody else? What if that is not a call for shame, a call to correct our shame, but simply a call to move into the greater picture of compassion, right? That shame leads to compassion. Shame is a portal for compassion. Some people struggle with lack. What if lack is abundance in disguise? What if lack is summoning us to a greater consciousness of abundance, to a greater awakening to abundance? You know, I think it's the Taoist says that, say that we should enter into sufficiency while it is still insufficiency. They both exist simultaneously all the time. One of the things that that I struggle with as we're reinventing the church is not knowing what to do and recognizing that some of the efforts that I've made have been futile. They have felt futile. I think that's a funny word right now. Am I saying it right? Futile. Okay. I like futile. It sounds very Southern to me. Yeah, so some of the efforts that I've made have been futile. So I struggle with futility. But then, as I start to shift through prayer into that greater mind, into that unitive consciousness, into that non-dual mystical seeing that we talk about here quite a bit, remember we are a center of mystical non-duality. So as I start to shift into that, I say, wait a minute, maybe I'm holding too tight a definition on the term futility. Maybe futility is really something else in disguise. Maybe futility is just an understanding that the possibility of spirit is so much bigger than my human mind can comprehend right now. So maybe if I just release this death grip that my ego has on futility, maybe I can just let go and allow some of that greater mind to trickle in more and more and more every day. Every time we let go of that thing that is getting us stuck, that thing that is holding us back, that thing that feels like we are, that we are bound, every time we let go of it just a little bit, a little more freedom comes in. A little more freedom comes in. And if we do that day after day after day after day, which is kind of a pain in the butt, right? We want it to happen once. We want to do it once and then be like, oh, I've arrived. But no, because impatience also is a call for greater patience, greater trust. And trust is the greatest thing, the greatest quality that we can have. So every time we practice, and life gives us many opportunities to practice. Every time we practice, we can open up more to that consciousness of oneness, that consciousness of wholeness, that consciousness of unity, and that trust that all is well and everything is conspiring for not only our greater good, but for the greater good of all. Does that make sense? I hope so. You gonna do it? Hallelujah. Okay. You gonna do it, Barb? You going to repent? Okay. Bernie, you going to change your thinking? Hallelujah. Right. Right. Karen Mondragon, yes, is going to tell us how it's done. Oh, God. She's going to tell us how she did it. And I'm thinking, let's have you use Bill's. Bill's, you don't have any cooties, do you? Okay. Good to know.
Do I need to get on my knees to do that?
No. No, we're going to give you the handheld. Okay, there we go. Bill, do you have any cooties? You'd be like, actually, yes, I have. Yeah. Okay. Why don't you stand up here, baby? That way the heads of the mystics aren't cut off.
Hello, good morning. And I'm going to... Bonnie asked us if we had a prayer story to tell. And the one I picked is over 30 years old. That's how long ago it was. Before, I did not know what Science of Mind was. I never heard of it. I did not know a five-step prayer treatment and never heard of that. So I did believe in God and I did believe in Jesus, and at that time I was a holy roller Pentecostal person. So I had passion is what I had. Now this prayer, for those of you who don't know, I've been a prayer practitioner for over 20 years, a practitioner, and I taught prayer, I teach prayer. I'm passionate about the five steps. If you've been in any of my classes, you know that. I'm really, really a stickler because the five steps are not for God, they're for us. They're for us to get in that mind-heart connection when we pray. So this prayer came about, I'm going to set the stage here. Over 30 years ago, I had my first apartment over on Santa Clara Street. I don't know the directions, wherever it is. And I had a job, I worked for the county, but I only barely had enough money to pay my rent. So this one day, my son lived with me and he had just graduated high school. He also had a job doing, not delivering papers, but delivering papers to the paper boys. So he would get up at 3 a.m. We had one car and I let him use it. I walked to work. This one morning I got up and I went into my kitchen and I can still remember everything about this day. I opened the cupboard, there was one can of tomato soup, Campbell's tomato soup, and it wasn't a pop-top can at that time, and a part of premium Ritz crackers. And that's all I had in the house. I think there was some milk in the refrigerator. And I remember thinking, oh man, you know, where am I gonna get food? I didn't have any money. We got paid like every other week then or whatever it was, and most of my money was gone. So I didn't have anything to buy food. And I was in a state in my kitchen, and I was feeling helpless, hopeless, and didn't know what to do. And my ego was stopping me from asking for help. There's no way. I wasn't gonna call my mom and say, I need some money to buy food, because that would make me feel like a failure. And I already felt like that, you know, at that time in my life. So I started, tears started coming to my eyes. I didn't know what to do. I was frustrated. I went in the bathroom, I was brushing my hair to get ready to leave. And all of a sudden, I just put my brush down, and my heart opened, and I just said, you know, my prayer was like four words. And I said, I need help, God. I need help. I need food. And as soon as, and I said it with so much passion in my heart, that as soon as I picked my brush up and I finished brushing my hair, it was, the energy was gone. And I went to work, and I was at work, and that afternoon at lunchtime, it was our lunch break, and I didn't have lunch because I didn't have food for lunch, but I put my sneakers on and go for a walk. And the director of the department where I worked, his secretary was a friend of mine, and she came to me and she said, Dr. So-and-so wants to talk to you in his office. And I went, oh, crap, now I'm going to get fired. What did I do? So I went in there all, you know, not knowing what to expect, because I've never been called in his office before. And he said, he closed the door and he said, I want to give you something. And I said, oh? And he said, here's $100, no strings attached. I know that you're in a predicament right now, and I want you to have this. And I just didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to say. And he said, you know, it's a gift. If you want to pay me back, you can do it whenever you have some money. And it doesn't matter how long it takes you, but I want you to go. He said, you know, I spend more than this on other things in my life. So, I mean, the moral of the story is the passion, the belief, and the instantaneous manifestation. Now, this, I didn't know Frederick. I mean, we've been married for 30 years, and this was way before I even met him. So that's how long ago this was. But I to this day, I'm grateful. To this day, I feel the gratitude in my heart for that man to have heard what I needed to have done for me, and to be kind enough to give me the money so that night I could go buy food to put in my house. And, you know, we teach five steps, and they're wonderful. And I pray all the time, and I use the five steps. They're automatic. But this prayer had the components of how we teach prayer. It had the belief, which is the absolute amazing thing we need. It had the belief, it had the passion, and it had the surrender. Because as soon as I said it, I let go. And I just knew, I didn't know how, but I just felt better. I felt like something was going to happen, and it did. So the manifestation was wonderful, and the gratitude 30 plus years later is still in my heart.
Hmm. So. Thank you, Karen. Okay. I got it. Thank you. It was wonderful. Thanks so much. So, you know, a couple of things about what Karen said. I think last week when we were speaking to the registered nurse, I mentioned that so often when we do something small, that we feel like, you know, it's that thing about futility again. It's like, how is this going to make a difference, right? And yet, $100, 30 years later, Karen's still rippling that story out to many people. And perhaps you'll ripple it out to people. And perhaps you won't even tell the story, but perhaps you'll take some of what she said or some of what I said and apply it to your life. Perhaps you'll look at your life where you seem to be stuck in ego, where you seem to be stuck in that operating system that divides and separates, where you're saying this person is bad or this situation is bad. I read the other day that the only thing we're grateful for are the things that we think we can control. And you know, if we're stuck in that place of saying this is bad, this is not working, what if there was a different way? What if there was a way to surrender and say, oh, God is good. I keep coming back to only God is good, or there is no God but God, meaning that everything is God. That's a blend of Christianity and Islam. Everything is God. And this is coming up for a reason. This is coming up for an awakening. This is coming up so that I may know deeper the wholeness of my life and the wholeness of everybody involved in this situation, the wholeness of the entire world and the entire universe. If we can take that consciousness, if we can identify first where we're feeling out of alignment with the spiritual truth that all is well, If we start catching ourselves saying all is well except for that over there, or all is not well, if we can catch ourselves in that act of blasphemy, then I would suggest that we move into a place where we're saying, wait a minute, is that the truth? And how can I think of this differently? And can I open my heart to receive the prayer that I need to pray? And in so doing that, our brother Ernest Holmes said that the answer to prayer is the prayer itself. And it's a beautiful place to be, because prayer automatically shifts our consciousness into that place of unity, not only with God, but with all beings, with all substance, with all matter. And from that place of unity, we are able to receive exactly what we need. We're already receiving exactly what we need anyway, but we get to see it in a new light and actually take it in. Let's take it in now. Let us pray. And so we turn within to trust and know this beautiful, beautiful power in this presence. We know the life that is God is all there is, and that God is good, and that goodness prevails. No matter what the outer appearance is, there is this core of goodness that underlies everything. There is this core of goodness that is this infinite organizing principle in the universe. And yes, sometimes it is disguised. Sometimes it is disguised in appearances. Sometimes we are blind to it, but it is always there. And so we unify with that goodness right now. We see it in whatever capacity we can see it. And then we go deeper. And we look at a place in our life where we may feel stuck, where we may feel at odds with someone or something, where something feels like it's not working. And we allow ourselves to open our minds and open our hearts to receive and believe in more of the goodness that prevails through all things. We pray the prayer of acceptance. We pray the prayer of surrender. We pray the prayer of Spirit, help me to see this differently. We pray the prayer of trust, knowing that in Spirit all things are possible. And with that, we are transformed. Even in this moment, the prayer itself transforms at least a small piece of our heart, if not more. We build upon that in the coming days, and our hearts continue to open wide to be more of who we came here to be, divine beings of love, divine beings that spread kindness and joy and peace throughout the world, divine beings who remember the unity of all beings, the wholeness of everyone. And so I am just so grateful to know this truth this morning with all of you here today, so grateful to know the truth with people that will watch it later, so grateful, just so grateful for the transformation that I know is occurring in small yet powerful ways. I'm also grateful for this spiritual center, this Kindness Cathedral and everybody in it. I'm grateful for all paths to God, churches, temples, mosques, ashrams, synagogues, fundamentalists, atheists, agnostics, everyone and so much more. And with a heart that is so filled with gratitude, I say, thank you, Spirit. Thank you, God. And I release these words into the divine mystery. And together we say, and so it is.
Can you sense how the spiritual authority in our house keeps getting deeper and richer every time?
By house, do you mean the church?
Yeah.
Okay.
Our house.
Okay.
The cathedral.
Okay.
Okay, so whatever you can contribute, whatever, hold it next to your heart. And if you feel like you don't have enough to contribute, that's not true. Actually, you have something, and it doesn't matter what it is. It's just that it's real. What matters is that it's real. So hold it next to your heart, whatever it is that you can contribute. And there's a little line that somebody's supposed to read, but I don't know it, so Bonnie's going to read it.
Please repeat after me. I trust in spirit. Love is the giver and receiver of all that I am. I offer my gift. It is an outer expression of my inner abundance. Our gifts bless many and return to us multiplied in miraculous ways. Thank you. Thank you. Our next song is for Father's Day, and it's based on that quote that I did in the service about plant a radish, get a radish, how sometimes prayers really are direct. You get the exact thing that you planted, but sometimes you get something really surprising and unexpected and bewildering. Take it away, boys.
How's your garden?
Growing.
Mine too. So dependable. Gardens go on growing.
They do.
I tell you, I love vegetables.
It's true. I love them too.
Plant a radish, get a radish, never any doubt. That's why I love vegetables. You know what you're about. They're dependable.
They're befriendable.
They're the best pal a parent's ever known. While with children, you don't know until the seed is nearly grown just what you've sown. So
plant a carrot, get a carrot,
never. That's why I love vegetables, you know what you're about. Life is merry, vegetarian. A man who plants a garden is a very happy man. But if your issue doesn't kiss you, then I wish you luck. For once you've planted children, you're absolutely stuck. Every turnip green, every kidney bean, every plant grows according to the plot. It's hodgepodgeny, for as soon as you think you know what kind you've got, it's what they're not. So plant a cabbage, get a cabbage. That's why I love vegetables, you know what you're about. Life is merry, vegetarian. A man who plants a garden is a very happy man.
A vegetarian.
Very merry, vegetarian.
Awesome. You did?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't hear it. Yeah. So there you go, folks. Okay, let's see what's next. Oh, announcements. I almost forgot. Okay, so what are we doing here? Okay, first thing is the flower dedication. So the flowers today, this is the Academy Awards, okay? The flowers today are dedicated to Annette Bennett. There's more. Thank you for 15 years of skilled, dedicated, exceptional service to all of us. We love you, VCSL. Let's give Annette. Yeah. And it's not really time in the service to do this, but for those of you who have not been here before, we sometimes scream out, thank you, Annette. So when I say three, we bellow, thank you, Annette, and we'll listen for her response, okay? It's super fun. Here we go. One, two, three. Thank you, Annette! There she is. Okay. All right. There's a wonderful class coming up. Mary and David are great teachers. David was the guy who was just up here singing about how much he hates children. No, I'm kidding. No, he loves his children. And Mary's also a very skilled teacher. And they're doing a class on Ernest Holmes and the Buddha. They're both experts on those topics, so it should be really fun. That starts in late July, and all of the details are on our website, which is www.venturacsl.org, and you look under the Classes tab. The fourth Wednesday meditation is called You Are Full of God. Okay, Wednesday, I was going to say you. Okay, sorry. It lends itself to humor. You are full of whatever. Okay, God. Sorry, Deborah. I'm so sorry. Okay, Wednesday, June 23rd, 6:30 p.m. It's facilitated by Deborah Gibson, and that's happening on Zoom. And that's it for that. And then, so as you know, California reopened, and we're continuing to work with the state to keep everybody safe. As you probably read in the newsletter, we are inviting people who have been vaccinated to remove your masks if you want. If you haven't been vaccinated or you have some type of pre-existing condition, go ahead and wear your mask. If you're uncomfortable with somebody who's maskless, you can always ask them to put it on for whatever reason. Later on, shortly, we're making decisions about hospitality, which is where we serve food in those back rooms there. There are cookies there today, though. There's some cookies in little plastic bags. And we're also opening up the youth program fairly soon, so we need to figure that out. And midweek meditations are coming up, too, possibly in person very soon. After service options today, like I said, there's cookies back there. You can get prayer with a practitioner. You can come down front and get prayer with a practitioner. She will take you where you need to go in prayer, but also physically if there's a mask or immunity issue going on. And then, whoa, did I do that? Kenny's mad at me. No. and also you can go in the social hall. We're still giving away free books and puzzles, and there's, like I said, a few cookies. I seem to be obsessed about those cookies. Did you know there's cookies in the social hall? Yeah, okay. I think that's it for the announcements. So we'll continue to keep you posted about how the church is evolving. At some point, we'll have a meeting and we'll talk about it. What's this going to mean for us and how can we all help? But for now, let us just pray and say goodbye. So Chris, go for it. Oh, we did it. Yeah, yeah. Oh, well, yeah. Give it to Nat. Okay. All right. Let me get into prayer here. Alrighty, so just turning within and trusting that this time together has just been so much fun, just fun and festive and filled with light and filled with love, filled with the joy of spirit, filled with the peace of spirit. I trust that people have come here today to have their hearts uplifted and their minds expanded, and that we have felt the love of this community together in all of the folks that contributed to make this service happen. And that there is goodness in everything that happened today, even the snafus, even the popping microphone, the crazy tech, that it's all good. It's all God expressing for reasons that we may not know. So we take this metaphor of this service and we bring it into our life, and we just see that everything that happens in life is just the power and the presence of God having fun with us, teaching us, leading us into greener pastures of wholeness and goodness. And so I'm just so grateful for this time together, so grateful for this center, for this kindness cathedral, and for all that we can do in the world to make the world a blessed place. I give thanks once again, and with a heart so filled with gratitude and so filled with love for everyone here today and everyone beyond, I say thank you, Spirit, thank you, love, and I release these words into the divine mystery. And together we say, and so it is. Thank you.